Given your understanding of the lives of cells, what do you think of chemotherapy?
Well, let's first start with a chemotherapy paradox. We had a cat die of cancer years ago, and the cat was quite old, 18, I think.
Talking about Sasha?
This was Abercrombie. And anyway, we had a discussion with the vet about the possibility of chemotherapy, and it didn't make sense in light of how old an animal this was. This was an animal at the end of his life. But what surprised me was that chemotherapy in cats, according to the vet, was very successful and didn't have any of the awful side effects that we know from human chemotherapy. So that does lead to a what the hell kind of question. Why would that be?
Yeah.
I will also say,
well, we don't know how chemotherapy in cats differs, right? Like, you know, chemotherapy.
Why should it, I mean, as a general category, it shouldn't differ at all.
Well, but I mean, there are some compounds that,
sure,
more so for dogs, but like there's some things that can't, you know, cats, sure, have a different diet than humans. There's some things that they can't eat that we can, and vice versa.
But chemotherapy is bound to involve many, many different compounds for different types of cancer, and that's going to be true for cats too. So it's not surprising to me that some chemotherapy,
if it was different and you could get that response in cats, why wouldn't you also get that response in humans?
Right. Yeah. And I will also say there's another place where I see the same style of paradox, and I'm not even sure that this one isn't just bullshit, but we seem to have a lot of trouble when we have capital punishment finding a combination of drugs that reliably extinguishes the convicted person painlessly.
Pain, yeah.
Right. And yet we euthanize animals routinely, and by all appearances, it is completely effective, and there's no reason in the world that this should be any different with a human being besides dosage. There's no reason it should be different with a human being versus a dog or a cat. So I kind of think it's just bullshit, and at some level, we're not trying to find those compounds, and we haven't bothered to ask a vet because that would be, you know, the cruelty is a feature, not a bug. So that's my cynical take. But anyway,
yep.
Chemotherapy is a bummer. I do believe that the basic premise of kill the cancer faster than you kill the patient is viable, but that it is bound to accelerate aging across the body.
That's where I think the question is originating from, right?
Yep.
Like, given your work on
yep.
senescence and telomeres and such,
yep.
won't it cause distributed aging in various cellular lineages across the body,
yep.
or at least anywhere the chemo hits? Yeah.
Yep, it will.
Right.
And I will say, someone we know and love had breast cancer, had it removed, and had a kind of therapy, not chemo, but radiation, that struck me as extremely clever, where instead of, the problem with radiation is if you have a beam of radiation, it goes through the patient, right? All the way through the healthy tissues and the suspect tissues. In this person's case, they embedded temporarily the radioactive element so it could irradiate surrounding tissue.
And you get like the exponential decay. Like it's right at source where it needs to be. And, you know, is it getting into a little bit of healthy tissue? Yes, but it was so localized.
Yeah, it was just
so
barely.
Perfect.
And in fact, I forget which kind of decay it is, if it's beta decay, but there's one of the kinds of decay
remember.
That doesn't penetrate very far.
Yeah.
And so anyway, this struck me as very elegant. It took something that is draconian, medically draconian, and made it, you know, trivially bad.
No, and this was cutting edge in, I guess this probably would have been 2014. And it still feels like, wow, I'm amazed that we can do that.
Yep.
Really extraordinary.
It's a great technology. And in principle, there is no reason you couldn't do something like this with chemo, where the idea is that something that breaks down is embedded, or probably better, more to the point, you could use something like monoclonal antibodies that are specifically programmed for your chemical idiosyncrasies of your cancer to basically float around and not stick to you, and then stick to the cancer and deliver the chemical toxin right to the location. I know that that's the kind of thing that people have been playing with for years, so I don't know that it's ever come to fruition or not. But chemotherapy bad, there are probably tricks to do
away
with.
But in some cases, the best possibility of that, in lots of cases.
Absolutely. Yeah. I will say that there is a general issue with doctors will often elect not to take therapies for something like cancer that they would advise their patients to take. Mm-hmm. In some sense, the bias in medicine is, you know, the patient is frightened and doesn't want to die.
There's a bias to treat.
Yeah.
Because not treating seems like it invites litigation.
Well, it invites litigation, and it also, you know, you have somebody terrified in your office who you've just told, you know, that they have a tumor and that, you know, it's fatal. Mm-hmm. And the desire to live longer is completely understandable. But the question is, there is a trade-off between quality of life and length of life. And unless you've thought about that issue carefully ahead of time, then, you know, grasping for more life makes sense. But a doctor who's seen the cost up close may have a very different sense about whether it's worth it.
Yeah.
And I will point out that very...
You can't measure quality of life, really. But it seems like the analysis here is, in some of these cases, the best case scenario might be you have 100 units of quality of life. And you could experience those 100 units over 2 years or over 1 year.
Yep.
Right? And, you know, do you want to have a better 1 year or a half as good 2 years starting now?
Yeah.
Right?
Absolutely. And I will say that this is not about chemo or treatment, but Norm MacDonald's death, I think, is a topic that just does not get enough attention.
I don't remember the circumstances.
Well, the circumstances were medically unremarkable. He was diagnosed with cancer, and it was terminal. And I will tell you, I actually interacted with him over Unity. He was interested. He expressed some interest, and I was like, hey, can we get you on board? Can we have you on a podcast? Something like that.
Yeah.
And he was like, I don't know. Right? He didn't want to do it. And I did not know at the time that he was terminally ill. But of course, nobody knew that he was terminally ill because he did.
Yeah.
He literally didn't tell anyone.
Yeah.
And the reason I think that that's important is that he availed himself of a kind of value that most people bypass, where he got to live the end of his life without cancer being the story.
Mm-hmm.
Right? He actually, you know, okay, you've got a certain number of months to live or a year to live. And the point is, well, I'd actually like to just have it.
Yeah.
I don't want everybody who interacts with me to be thinking, oh, is this the last time I'm going to see you? Right? I just want it to be normal. That's what I want, is another year of normal life or something mm-hmm. like that. And so anyway, I don't know what the answer is, but it did strike me as this was a very intelligent guy,
mm-hmm.
right? Also very unusual. And that he did something very unusual at the end of his life was profound.
That's fascinating. I've forgotten that if I knew it. I'm recalling, I think, some other famous person who obscured from her family and loved ones that she was sick until either she was gone or like she had 2 days left or something. And I don't remember any of the details, even who it was, but as I remember it, there was at least one of her friends who thought of herself as very close, anyway, which may be part of the story here, who was furious. Said, I wanted to be able to say goodbye. How dare you keep me from being able to say goodbye? And I thought, oh, but I believe that what you got instead was a number of interactions with your friend. It may be that there is something that she needed to say. And I think it was two women in this case, that she really felt she needed to say. In which case, if you have those things, you should figure out a way to say them.
Yeah.
You should figure out a way to say them rather than know that like you're definitely going to want to do this before either of you die, because obviously that could happen to anyone at any moment. And it also felt like, you know, at some level it was a way to be angry at the situation and appear to be angry at the now dead friend rather than going through your grief or as part of your grief. But it felt like it misunderstood the value in the decision. And it as I remember it, it was presented as there was only one right thing to have done here. You owe it to inform the world when you get a diagnosis like this. And I thought, no, you do not. I mean, and in part, I'm able to come to that conclusion very easily because so many of these diagnoses are only possible because of very recent technological developments. And so you wouldn't know. And if there's a situation in which you wouldn't know, and if there's any part of you that wishes you didn't know, you certainly don't owe it to everyone else to inform them.
Right. And, you know, the other part of you, you definitely said it, but I think it should be emphasized, which is to the extent that you think you have a right to know a life-ending diagnosis that somebody receives because you have things you need to say to them, those are things you need to say. And you know, the idea that you're waiting until you know somebody's on the way out is preposterous, you know? So those are not easy conversations to have, but I am a fan of the idea that you should keep accounts current.
Yeah. I mean, I guess there are, of course, things in some relationships and some families that you don't want a person to be living with.
Yeah.
But you feel, for what I'm not coming up with an example right now, and we're lucky not to have this.
Yeah.
But where you feel like, actually, I want them to know this, even though they'll only know it for, you know, although I guess most of the time that's, it goes the other way.
Yeah.
It's, I don't want to live with this knowledge in the universe, but it, it should be out there now that I'm not around to have to deal with it or the repercussions or whatever it is.
Yeah. No, I do think it usually goes the other way.
That wasn't really about chemotherapy, but I see
how we got there.
No, we started there.
Yeah.